Welcome to our Embedded Wearable webinar. This is the Design Wearable Healthcare Systems with Advanced Sensing and Efficient Power for Improved Patient Monitoring Session, being presented by Sanjay Pitadia. My name is Kelvin Lee, and I'll be the moderator for the session. All participants are muted during the session. Please use the chat function to ask questions and address to everyone. We'll be answering questions throughout the webinar and chat. Also chat if you're having any problems hearing or seeing the presentation. Let me introduce Sanjay very quickly. Sanjay Pitadia is a system engineer and part of the member group technical staff at Texas Instruments, where he is responsible for developing subsystem design resources for medical applications. Sanjay has been with TI since 2008 and has been involved in designing reference designs related to energy, smart grid, industrial motor drives, medical imaging, and patient monitoring. Sanjay brings to his role his experience in analog design, mixed signal design, industrial interfaces, and power supplies. And with that, I'll hand off to Sanjay to get started.
Yep, thanks, Kelvin. So hello and welcome to this webinar. My name is Sanjay Pitadia. I'm systems engineer here at Texas Instruments. And I would like to thank each one of you for taking out time for this webinar. So let's get started. So here is a high-level agenda for this webinar. And we will start with an introduction to TI's classification of medical sector. Then we will talk about market trends and design challenges. And lastly, we will discuss about TI's subsystem level reference designs, which can help in quick prototyping and reducing the design cycle for our customers. So TI, in fact, classifies medical market into five different categories: imaging, patient monitoring and diagnostics, medical equipment, home healthcare, and personal care and fitness. The medical imaging consists of equipments which are related to some image of the patients, for example, ultrasound scanners, X-ray machines, MRI, and CTPT scanners. Right? The patient monitoring and diagnostic category takes care of all the vital signs, mainly sensing and monitoring of those signs. And now, if we consider this patient monitoring category as category which takes human vital signs as inputs, then medical equipment category is mostly output devices like ventilators, infusion pumps, anesthesia machines, and etc. The fourth category is home healthcare category, which covers devices which are mostly used at home, like the blood pressure monitors, glucose monitors, CPAP machines, nebulizers, oxygen concentrators, and you can name some other similar equipments. And the final category, personal care and fitness, includes devices like wearable fitness monitors, beauty and grooming like shavers, etc., and treadmills. And in this presentation, we will talk about patient monitoring and diagnostics category. Now, before we dive deeper into the session, I would like to show where you can find all the medical-related content on our website. Now, once you type www.ti.com in your browser, it will show our homepage, and one can click on applications and applications section on the top corner, top left corner, and it will show different markets and sectors which Texas Instruments supports. Now, just click on the medical sector and within this industrial market, and it will open up our medical portal. And as I highlighted earlier in this webinar, that it will show five different categories within medical sector. Each blue text, blue color text that corresponds to a product or equipment, and it is actually clickable. So let's take an example. So within patient monitoring category, right? If I click on medical sensor patches, it opens up key design challenges and a high-level block diagram. And each block here is clickable with more information, like reference designs for that particular subsystem and recommended products from TI. And you can go into more details about this. right? So these are some products, some reference designs and this. So I'm talking about this reference design. So what is a reference design? A reference design is a subsystem level circuit or a design which combines multiple integrated circuits from Texas Instruments and solves a design challenge for our customer. If you are aware of evaluation modules from TI, then reference design is not an evaluation module. It is actually a resource for our customers with comprehensive design guide, detailed calculations, equations, full schematics, layout, Gerbers, and design files. As the name suggests, it is a tested reference design to help our customers in reducing the design cycle. But remember, it's not a full product for any of our customers. Now, patient monitoring is not new, but the market is growing. For example, the growing elderly population drives the high demand of remote monitoring. In many countries, billions of dollars are being spent every year on chronic diseases. Remote monitoring has become a trend, and it not only enhances the quality of care, but also reduces overall healthcare cost while providing mobility advantage to the patient. Especially wearable wireless medical technology enables accurate and reliable data in a very small form factor. The challenges to tackle with this medical devices, right? Wearable medical devices are mainly the battery life, the variety of vital signs or modalities in a very small form factor design. Now, once the vital signs are monitored, captured, and sent for processing, artificial intelligence can be used for analysis. It can improve the decision making and help in early prevention of the diseases. Before we go into details, let's briefly talk about ECG, PPG, and some of the physiologies behind that. So ECG stands for electrocardiogram, which is an electrical measurement of the heart activity. And during each heartbeat, the cardiac muscle tissue contracts in a specific sequence in order for blood to flow in the proper direction, passing from one chamber to the next inside the heart. The contraction of each segment in the heart produces its own depolarization waveform, and like the ones shown on the left. And on the other side, PPG stands for photoplethysmogram, which is an optical measurement of an organ's volume. So in principle, PPG is measured by illuminating the skin and subcutaneous tissue with the light of a specific wavelength from an LED or light-emitting diode. This light is either absorbed, passed through, or reflected back. And the photodiode sensor on the other side measures the light that is either transmitted or reflected, depending on whether it is placed relative to the LED. The light is then converted to an electrical signal, and pulse oximeter is the most common device used to measure the PPG. These devices are use two specific wavelengths of light: red, which is 660 nanometers, and infrared, which is 940 nanometers. And the absorption of light at each wavelength allows physicians to isolate the light absorbed by the arterial blood from venous blood and other type of tissues. Now, this is primarily used as an indicator of oxygen concentration in patient's bloodstream. And when measured simultaneously with ECG, we can overlay both these waveforms, ECG and PPG, and both waveforms will have same period, meaning that either can be studied to determine the heart rate, but the time difference between the R peak in the ECG waveform and the peak of PPG waveform can be calculated, which is something called pulse transit time, and it can actually be used for some other calculations like systolic blood pressure and other parameters for the patient. So this table summarizes the difference between ECG and PPG measurements. It compares features of both ECG and PPG measurements. I'm not going to go into each features, but it is important to highlight that ECG and PPG have their own benefits and ways to provide diagnostic information. So for ECG, a lead is kind of a voltage difference between two points on the body. And for most leads, each point is measured by an independent electrode through some, and some can be calculated. And the number of leads and ECG system can vary widely. Simpler ECG systems generally have no more than first two or the three primary leads. And typically, these are all consumer applications and small portable ECG equipments meant for basic diagnostics. But on the other hand, high-quality diagnostic systems are more complex and may use up to 15 different leads. So this table summarizes what leads you measure for single lead, three leads, six leads, and 12 lead ECG, and also shows how many ADC channels are required to measure each one of these. Now, if we look at frequency domain, right, the AC component of ECG waveform is relatively low in frequency, usually between 0.05 hertz and 40 hertz. And diagnostic quality ECG applications may require up to 150 hertz bandwidth or more to extract additional information from the waveform. This diagram shows where ECG falls in the frequency spectrum relative to other biopotential measurements. Again, we need to note that the magnitude of ECG is just a few millivolts. Right? Now, as we alluded to earlier, there are some common challenges to measuring ECG. These challenges usually come from power line interference or also come from, or it's also called 50 or 60 hertz pickup. It can come from baseline DC instability, which comes from poor electrode connections. It can be muscle shaking and wandering baseline from changing DC level of the electrodes. And some of these design challenges can be overcome with a good circuit design, but most often digital post-processing is required to bandpass filter the ECG waveform from DC drift or high frequency interference. So software plays a very significant role in removing all these different noise coming from different sources. When we talk about optical measurement, right, what are the challenges in optical biosensing? Apart from longer battery life, which is a common challenge with all the wearable products, PPG measurement uses LED for transmitting the light and photodiode for receiving the reflected signal, as I highlighted earlier. But the patient's skin tone variation can really affect the received signal. Its amplitude is highly dependent on the skin color. While combining the LED and photodiode circuit in a small form factor, the performance with glass and lens is also important, along with the cancellation of ambient light and correction in software. And many wearable monitors also have motion cancellation algorithms to compensate for any motion artifacts. So with these challenges, let's dive deeper into some of the solutions from Texas Instruments, which can help solving these challenges. So let me start with our first reference design. It's called TIDA-1614. It's a reference design for multi-parameter front-end for vital signs patient monitors. It measures ECG, heart rate, SpO2, respiration rate, and skin temperature. Since the block diagram on this slide is very small and not very clearly visible, let me blow it up and show in detail. So the ECG, heart rate, and respiration rate, these three parameters are measured using dedicated ECG chip called ADS1292R. And the circuit enables three electrode operation, including the right leg drive with good common mode rejection ratio. The SpO2 measurement is done using a dedicated PPG IC, AFE4403, which uses transmissive type of PPG measurement and can take input from finger clip kind of connector, which is shown on the left side. For measuring skin temperature, the reference design supports three temperature sensors through external board connection. And this temperature sensor boards use TI's latest temperature sensor, TMP117, which is plus minus 0.1 degree accurate sensor. There is also an option to connect pace detection circuit to indicate presence of a pacemaker. And this reference design operates either from a 5-volt USB input or from a single-cell lithium-ion battery and has battery charging and other power components on board. The raw data for all the vital signs are available over isolated UART interface shown on the right side. Now, what design challenges does this reference design solve? It actually helps in two important aspects. One is integration of multiple modalities with enough bandwidth, single amplitudes, signal amplitudes, and signal to noise ratios. The second one is, of course, the protection and isolation to support patient safety. Now, to highlight more on the signal chain, the signal chain circuit is protected using resistors for limiting the current on electrodes, common mode and anti-aliasing filters to reject the high frequency noise, and diode circuit to protect against defibrillator shocks. Also, it is important to understand that the DC specifications like offset or gain error and non-linearity do not matter because the offset of the skin electrode contacts are typically much larger than the errors introduced by an instrumentation amplifier itself. However, the input bias current, impedance, and noise numbers are really important for this application. The right leg drive amplifier has two purposes. It biases the patients to a proper voltage range and cancels out common mode interference. This reference design board is of a cell phone size, which can be worn on an arm or on the waist while supporting patient mobility. And this slide shows design specifications, a test setup showing how it is tested using ECG simulator and a graphical user interface to show all the different parameters. Just remember that this GUI schematic layout, Gerber's test results, everything is available on TI.com. You need to just search for TIDA-01614. So here is the same GUI, which shows ECG, respiration, SpO2, and three temperature signals. In fact, it also shows an indication of pace pulse along with the rise time, amplitude, and the width of the pace pulse. So now let's move to the wearable patient monitor reference designs. The TIDA 1580 is another design, which is, again, it realizes a wearable patient monitor. It's a very simple multi-parameter patient monitor that provides raw data to calculate heart rate, SpO2, and pulse transit time. The single-chip biosensing front-end AFE4900 supports synchronized ECG and PPG measurements. It is the only device on the market with this level of integration, low power operation, small size, and flexibility. And we do have some latest devices after this, which was recently released. Now, this PPG or optical heart rate monitoring device, right? The SpO2 basically supports four LEDs and three photodiodes with digital ambient subtraction to improve the signal-to-noise ratio. And along with PPG, it supports single-lead ECG, the wireless data transfer over Bluetooth low energy 4.2 and 5.0 are supported by CC2640 R2F. It's an integrated ARM Cortex M3 device with 2.4 gigahertz RF transceiver. And it has internal DC-DC converter, which really helps improve the overall efficiency. There is a built-in low battery detection algorithm, which helps reduce the external components. And all digital peripherals, peripheral pins on this device can be routed to any GPIOs, which basically helps in better routing in a very small form factor design. The AFE4900 has flexibility of ultra-low power modes and integrated FIFO, first in, first out, which can keep the MCU in sleep mode to increase the battery operation time. Now, this reference design, as I show in the block diagram, it is operated from a small coin cell battery, CR3032. It's a 3-volt, 500 milliampere coin cell battery. And it offers 100 hours of continuous operation with this circuit. Now, if the operation is duty cycle for, let's say, 1 second per minute transmission, then battery life can go up to 30 days as per our testing. Now, let me highlight different boards on this design. It has three boards, sensor board, ECG board, and main board. The sensor board on the extreme left side bottom, the sensor board has LED and PPG sensor. The ECG board has just metal contacts, and both these gets connected to the main board, which has all these components. It can support multiple PPG sensors because the PPG board is plug-in type. So what you see, that small window, right, in the small window inside the this ECG board, that is actually showing the PPG sensor. There is one metal contact on top layer and another on the bottom for two electrodes of ECG measurement. And as I mentioned, the small window is from where the PPG sensor measures optical measure. It does optical measurement. So this is how our setup looks for TIDA 1580. The bottom side can touch the wrist. The bottom side can touch the wrist of one hand, let's say electrode one, and other hand can touch the pad on the top layer of the main board, which is, let's say, electrode two. And the raw data is captured and sent to the remote terminal, which can show synchronized ECG and PPG data. And here we have used a launch pad for CC2640R2F as a receive terminal, but definitely you can develop an application on a mobile phone or on a laptop to show the data. So what design challenges does this solve? The first and foremost is integration of modalities in a very small form factor. Now, capturing synchronized ECG and PPG to enable PTT or BP calculations, which is typically non-invasive and without cuff, can be challenging. And it is mainly because timing is the key. There are multiple aspects involved, like powering up, timely and clock timing, the phase, and drift with the temperature. The simultaneous measurement of ECG and PPG together, along with other variables such as patient size, weight, age, those can be used for further analysis by using this single device. The single device can help capturing both the data together. The second challenge is the RF interference due to Bluetooth connectivity. Now, as I mentioned earlier, right, the signal amplitudes are very low, typically 0.2 millivolts to 2 millivolts peak to peak. And it is important to reject environmental electrical signals such as AC mains, security systems, and other RF interference, and to amplify and display the actual ECG signal. So this reference design implements differential and common mode filtering using common mode chokes. Also, the board is four layers with a complete ground layer for shielding, and the placements of BLE chip and the AFE chip, these are done such that the interference is not there. And the third and very important design challenge is to improve the battery life. This can be done in multiple ways. For example, selecting the right power architecture, powering with the right buck or boost converters instead of directly powering from battery. And then there are some DC-DC converters which have bypass modes to improve the efficiency. The devices like the microcontroller, right, that can have sleep, shutdown, standby, deep sleep modes, which can be used to improve the battery life, and selection of right battery charger, like charging rate, termination current, quiescent currents. These are all important to enhance battery life further. So we do have a document or a journal article which was published in 2019, and it describes all these different techniques to improve the battery life in wearable patient monitors. So you can refer to this when the slides are shared with you. You can refer to this document as well. So we talked about PPG, we talked about ECG, PTT. What about temperature, right? So we do have a design called TIDA 01624. It's actually a Bluetooth-enabled high-accuracy skin temperature measurement flex PCB patch design. It is a very simple patch design with only two ICs on it. It has a temperature sensor and a BLE chip. The temperature sensor is TMP117, which is, again, a 0.1 degree C accurate temperature sensor. And the device for the Bluetooth is, again, the same device which we used in the previous design. This is CC2640R2F. The entire patch design is implemented on a flexible PCB. That means it can be bent and it takes the shape of the body part wherever it is connected. The silver color battery, what is seen here, is also a flexible battery. And the temperature updates every second and connects to the smart device like an iPad or iPhone or any remote terminal. So more details can be found on TI Web by searching TIDA-1624. Now, before we move into next reference design, let me quickly flash this one pager for TMP-117. As it can be seen, it is an ultra high accurate device and meets medical standards. It has integrated non-volatile memory, which can store configuration even after losing power. It is so small with 1.6 mm square package that it is ideal for any wearable application. Now, if we look at overall system, we do have multi-parameter patient monitors, which has connection to the nurse station, or it can be a doctor's office, it can be through Wi-Fi. And the sensor patches are connected to different patients that can communicate with the same patient monitor, the bedside patient monitor, through Bluetooth. And when we talk about this entire scenario of multiple patches connected to the bedside, and then back end it is connected to the nurse station, here is why you should consider Texas Instruments for your wireless connectivity requirements. The simple link solutions from TI are low power. They are easy to use because of multi-role support. They are secure with FIPS 140 level 1 validation and very small in size because of the BAW technology. And it is industry's first crystal-less wireless architecture, which saves approximately 12% area in the patch design. On the firmware side, right, you can reuse 100% of the code across your designs. All different technologies from Texas Instruments like Bluetooth, sub 1 gig, Wi-Fi, Zigbee, multi-standard, all can have common software using our SDK. So invest once and you can use it effortlessly. Right. So now I want to change gears and talk about how to achieve isolation and help ensure safety with power and data architectures in multi-parameter patient monitors. So now, by definition, a multi-parameter patient monitor measures multiple parameters like electrocardiogram or ECG, blood oxygen concentration or SpO2, temperature, blood pressure, CO2, they are also called like capnography, and multiple other gases, right? All these parameters are typically measured using small isolated modules, which can be connected to the main unit, and it's called the monitor. So what you see here is an example image of a patient monitor with different connectors, where all these different modules get connected. Now, these type of patient monitors are bedside or classic patient monitors, which we see in hospitals and clinics, right? But there's also a trend which we have seen of moving towards portable patient monitors, which are small units which can be worn on a waist or arm of the patient. The advantage of such portable type of patient monitors is basically patient mobility. However, the challenges for these patient monitors are not only size, but also quiescent current and efficiency with thermal performance. Patient safety is a global health priority, which is also highlighted by World Health Organization, so as to provide enough attention during the design and development of multi-parameter patient monitors. So if you are working on any medical equipment, you would be aware of medical standard called IEC 60601-1, and all medical devices must comply with the basic safety and essential performance requirements defined by this standard. So let's go in a little deeper into this. This standard basically provides general requirements in a series of editions and versions, and it has evolved over years through the fourth edition EMC standard that establishes new environments when considering electromagnetic compatibility, or you can say EMC, between the medical electrical equipment and other electronic devices. With the United States, Canada, and Europe now already having fully adopted fourth edition EMC requirements, the patient monitor manufacturers intending to ship products to these regions must also ensure their products comply to the latest standard. However, the same is equally true for manufacturers in regions that have not transitioned into the latest addition to the standard, right? While transition dates may not be clear in various territories or regions around the world, there is still incentive for manufacturers to comply to the global standards to avoid being caught by different regional compliances. The IEC 60601 standard has a long history with a number of revisions. Since 1977 till date, there have been multiple editions and versions. And in context of safe operation of medical equipment, the second edition of IEC 60601 established risk guidelines that applied when a device is within the 6 foot radius from a patient, or it's called patient vicinity. And three use categories are basically defines: type B, or body equipment operates within this vicinity but without patient contact. Examples of type B equipment can be an X-ray machine or MRI scanners. Type BF, which is body floating equipment, makes physical contact with the patient. Examples can be blood pressure monitors, ultrasound scanners, and thermometers. And the type CF, which is a third type, cardiac floating, makes physical contact with the heart. So it can be defibrillator or dialysis machines. Now, these types of body floating or cardiac floating decide applicable levels of isolation, insulation, creepage, and clearance for the equipment. There are specific tables are given in the IEC standard for the creepage and clearance requirements based on corresponding voltages across insulation, or maybe upper rated input voltage, whichever is highest. And the clearance calculation needs consideration of a multiplication factor if the altitude is greater than 3,000 meters. Also, power supplies use transformers for isolation purpose. So for transformer construction, a reinforced or basic isolation requirement is determined based on which type of insulation is used. For example, single or double or triple layer of insulation sheet will decide the thickness as well as the isolation level. Most of the AC converters are isolated. Then why do we need isolation on DC-DC power supplies? Right. So most of the by providing up to 5,000 volt isolation in most of the DC-DC converters can still protect the patient in event of failure of the main AC-DC power supply, and thereby avoiding mains voltage levels appearing at any patient points. And the sensing side, isolation is typically taken care by reducing the leakage current by adding resistors in the ECG sensing paths, for example. Now, the purpose of this data and power side isolation is twofold. For modules like ECG and temperature, there has to be isolation from patient to the circuit to make sure the leakage current passing through the patient's body is within safe limits. And secondly, when it connects to the main monitor, we need to understand that multiple other modules are also connected together. So providing isolation in each module is important. So I have not put many screenshots of the standard here because that may not be appropriate to share over webinar. But I think the main points are covered here. And then to get into further details, let's have a look at an example module. So the image on this slide shows a generic block diagram of ECG module. It highlights the isolation between the analog circuit and the digital processing unit. As highlighted earlier, the medical standard IEC 60601-1 specify that multi-parameter patient monitor needs to have isolation up to 5 kV to separate the grounds, prevent any ground loop currents, and prevent leakage currents flowing from the patient body. Now, while isolating the data, it also needs to have same level of isolation as on the power supply. And the data isolation can be done using simple digital isolators, but the isolated power supply really needs thoughtful analysis. For powerful the power architectures, there are key specifications which help in deciding the topology. So let's look at these challenges. So as we discuss with different medical customers across regions about these isolated power supplies, we get requirements like regulated or unregulated input voltage, output voltage range is changing depending on what is it powering, the power levels they would like to achieve, the feedback mechanism, some like open loop, some like closed loop. Or in other words, they also ask for output voltage regulation percentage, the isolation levels, the emission standards, of course, the bill of material, form factor, cost. They also play a major role in this topology selection. So in short, one size doesn't fit all these requirements. So we need to really dig deeper into possible architectures or topologies. So let's start with first topology, which is flyback. And I think it is a very, very famous topology. Conventional flyback converter is basically a buck boost converter. And it can easily support output power levels up to tens of watts, depending upon the transformer design. And to get the isolated output information back to the flyback controller or a PWM controller, in order to accurately regulate the output is fed back using either an optocoupler-based circuit or a tertiary winding, a third winding. Right, these two cases are shown on the bottom the images on the slide, and if you look at in such cases, the component count and the solution size is fairly large. In fact, reliability can be an issue or concern with optocoupler based feedback, and an additional winding adds again the cost to the transformer. So there is a variation of flyback called PSR flyback topology, which eliminates the need of an optocoupler or tertiary winding, and it provides extremely tight load regulation using the feature of the resonant ring caused by the magnetizing inductance at the switch node capacitance. And compared to the conventional flyback designs, right, it operates in discontinuous conduction mode, or boundary conduction mode, depending on the load condition. And it in turn eliminates any errors from the transformer DC resistance, or it's also called DCR, or the secondary side diode to provide tight regulation. However, higher primary and secondary side RMS currents in such flyback design can result in little higher conduction losses in magnetics and semiconductors. Now, TI suggests two new devices which can support this topology, LM5180 and LM25180. The difference between the two devices is the input voltage range. And table on the right shows specifications for LM5180 device. And it can support up to 7 watts and can achieve 1% output voltage regulation. Now, I want to also quickly show a design calculator. It's a tool for LM, both these devices, LM25180 and 5180, where the user can design and select components by inputting different specifications and parameters. And this one is again available on our website for anyone to download and use. Just go for a device, LM5180 or 25180, and you will find this as one of the design tools. There is another very famous topology, very popular for small bias power supplies, like or any auxiliary supplies. It's a push-pull topology, and it is a topology which utilizes transformer core magnetizing current very efficiently, which results in a smaller magnetic solution compared to any flyback or the conventional flyback design. For example, the SN6505 is a push-pull transformer driver specifically designed for small form factor isolated power supplies. It's an open loop push-pull topology, which simplifies the design by eliminating the feedback loop. The total component count is also very less. It's actually close to 6 components, excluding the output LDO, in the first figure on the top of the slide. That this transformer driver without any feedback cannot support wide input voltage range, of course, because there is no feedback. It's an open loop, and it requires very tightly regulated input voltage. And being an open loop topology, there is always a concern on output regulation. That is why the typical load regulation for SN6505 is 5 to 10%. And that is why I think we really need an LDO at the output for a very regulated output, or it can create output ringing for no load conditions. For some tighter output regulations, closed loop push-pull topology can also be used, but similar to conventional flyback, it needs an isolated feedback. It can be using optocoupler or any other mechanism. The power level, even if the power levels are like less than 5 watts or maybe less than 10 watts, you can see that overall component count of this design, which is shown on this bottom, is actually pretty high. The size is big. The component count is close to like 46 components, and it actually has like much more space. Much more space is given here compared to the SN6505 design. Now we talked about two different topologies. Now I want to highlight the integrated solutions. Now there are many innovations in transformer design, and high frequency topologies have enabled IC designers to integrate a transformer and silicon into one single IC. And for the end user, what you get, a very small, lightweight, isolated DC-DC power supply without having to design a transformer or compromise on the system performance. The traditional approaches like flyback or push-pull provide a lot of flexibility, but there is a drawback with discrete approaches. It is that the complete solution, the transformer and other components, occupy a lot of space on the board, and designing a stable system will also, it's actually can be challenging. So there are various latest solutions integrating DC-DC converter with a micro transformer. Here is an example of TI's latest device. It's UCC12050. It's an isolated power module, and it integrates a transformer and a DC-DC controller with a proprietary architecture to achieve high efficiency with very low emissions. The Z dimension with this device is just 2.65 millimeters, and it provides 500 milliwatts of typical output power, which is isolated at a peak efficiency of 60%. If you need more power, of course, multiple such devices can be used in the application. And this device brings many benefits to a wide variety of isolated DC-DC supply applications. It is designed with an EMI-optimized transformer with only 3.5 picofarad of primary to secondary capacitance and a very quiet control scheme. And on its own, the solution can pass CISPR32 Class B on a two-layer PCB without ferrite beads or LDOs. And we will talk about this in detail in upcoming slide. But the device is very robust. It's rated for reinforced isolation of 5 kV RMS and 1.2 kV RMS working voltage, and it can operate up to 125 degrees C ambient temperature. There is device called 12040, which is rated for basic isolation of 3 kV RMS and 800 volt RMS working voltage. And UCC12050 is targeted for 5 volt input, 3.3 volt to 5.4 volt output applications requiring 500 milliwatts. And of course, for higher input or output voltages, we will need some pre or post conversion. Now let's compare the total area size. The total area using UCC12050 is 53% lesser than the discrete solution. The total area is just 127 millimeter square compared to 273 millimeter square. And apart from the size, it simplifies the layout because of very less external components. We also did a comparison of efficiency and thermal performance of air core solution versus magnetic core solution. The measured peak efficiency of UCC12050 is 2x, the air core solution, and the temperature rise of magnetic core solution is 30 degree lower than any air core solution when operating at 5 volt input and 5 volt output at 100 milliamperes. One important point I would like to highlight here is also about emission. Compared to similar competition product but with air core, UCC 12050 is actually, I think I will move again to this slide. Compared to similar competition product but with air core, UCC 12050 can pass CISPR 32 as I already highlighted. And in an apple to apple comparison with competition, UCC 12050 has over 20 dB of emission improvements and a margin of close to 5.8 dB. And this has been tested in the lab with different conditions like no ferrite beads, no LDO, no stitch capacitors on a two-layer PCB. Another solution to highlight, which is also one of our device called IsoWatt. It's actually a device with reinforced quad-channel digital isolator with integrated DC-DC converter. The digital isolators operate up to 100 Mbps with a propagation delay of less than 16 nanoseconds. And the integrated DC-DC switch mode converter supports 130 milliamperes of load current with a 5-volt input and 75 milliamperes of load current with a 3.3-volt input. And the emission graph on this slide shows comparison of this device with competitor device for CISPR 22 Class B. So the device is called ISO-W. 7841 and 7821 for 4-channel and 2-channel respectively. Now, before I summarize and compare all the topologies, I wanted to talk about the data and or the signal isolators. So these are mainly designed to replace optocoupler-based isolated designs, and I highlight example of SPI isolation in this slide. So in the layout, we have optocoupler based design on the top and isolated based design on the bottom. And if we see the application diagram, it shows how it can be implemented. And the layout also shows how much space optocouplers can take and how much space digital isolators can save for a design. So here is a very high-level block diagram comparison of three solutions. First is SN6505-based open-loop push-pull power supply with separate 4-channel digital isolator. The custom layout takes around like 30 mm by 25 mm size. The second one uses UCC12050 with a separate digital isolator on bottom layer, and the overall size is 30 mm by 15 mm. And the third one is IsoWatt, ISO-W7841, with integrated digital isolator and power possible into same layout in the same size as UCC12050, which is 30 mm by 15 mm. But I think we need to really compare the Z size of each of these devices also. There is no specific reason for not including PSR flyback design here, but it will also take approximately same size as the first option here. And finally, a comparison summary for all the topologies in terms of different parameters. I don't want to go into each of them, but I think one thing is very important, which is emissions. So what we have seen is that typically, flyback topologies tend to be noisier than SN6505 because of spectrum clocking we have. And both conventional and PSR need a copper shield for good EMI performance as per our testing. The UCC 12050 uses EMI reduction schemes for internal oscillators and advanced internal layout with proprietary integrated transformer design. So EMI is very low with that device. And EMI performance of IsoWatt is mentioned moderate to high. It depends on the layout and external components as well. So all these slides will be shared with each one of you after this webinar. But we also have released an application report, which you can find on TI website, which covers all the things, all these, whatever I highlighted, right? It covers all these in details, right? So finally, if you're not aware, TI has an online E2E community where you can find answers to technical questions, connect with TI factory engineers, and also provide your expert comments, suggestions to other designers across globe. This is like worldwide TI E2E community. It's a platform for engineers to connect with engineers. So with this, I would like to end my presentation. I really appreciate you all taking out time to attend this presentation from Texas Instruments. And we can open up for some questions if there are any. Thank you.
Hey, Sanjay, there's a question in the chat here. Mm-hmm. How does spacing, does crimpage and clearances affect the safety of a device slash system?
Okay, so actually the standards specify that the crimpage and the clearance, there is a rule of thumb that maybe some, I think 8 mm corresponds to kind of 1 kV or something. I'm not really sure on that number right now, but the standard specifies that the spacing between the two input and output, let's say we want to isolate input and output, right? Spacing between the two will decide the isolation level. So the standard will have to refer to the exact standard, but then you can really see that each millimeter will correspond to one some particular kV, for example 1 kV or 2 kV or 3 kV. So if I go back to my slide here, right? So this shows this spacing, and I think it was mentioned somewhere here. This has around 5 kV RMS reinforced isolation, and the size is around 7.5 mm, so which is this one. So I think that is meeting the standard, the medical standards as well. And again, the same is also true for the ISOWatt, where you can see it is again 7.5 mm and it supports 5 kV RMS reinforced isolation. So I think, yes, the crimpage and clearance will be important based on what level of isolation you want to achieve. And it can be system level as well as it can be device level. So there are different things given in the standard. Any other questions? I mean, not necessarily on the isolated power supply, right? Even the previous section where we had variable designs and those things, right? Any questions on that can also be asked.
So there's a question about, is there an email support or design queries respect to 1580 couplers? So you can post these questions on E2E, and yeah, we'll have a representative contact you to support.
Yeah. So post your any of your questions related to any reference designs or any device, you can post on TI E2E community, and it will ultimately go to the right person within TI, and it will be answered within 24 hours.
All right, so here's another question. Is there any level of security implemented in the past reference designs, and could there be?
Okay, so the past design, right? As I mentioned, it uses CC2640R2F device, and the device actually supports AES-128 security module. We haven't implemented any encryption, But I think it is possible to implement, and you can find more details about that in the technical reference of that design. But on a patch design level, we haven't implemented any security, because as I mentioned earlier, right, at the start of my presentation, that these reference designs are basically helping our customers to reduce the design cycle and their evaluation time. So this is not a full product. So it is just giving some raw data, and you have to put your algorithms and other security aspects on that.
Okay. For the design TIDA 01580, the CC2640 and AC4900 share a power supply. Have you seen this affect the performance?
Yes, it's a very good question. Actually, what we did when we designed the board, the bottom and the top layers have this AFE and CC device, and they are placed diagonally opposite. So that is one thing, that they are on separate layers. For power supplies, we do have LC filters to separate all the power supplies with the ferrite beads in between. And also, as I highlighted, right, the AFE has common mode filtering at the input. So that is also making sure that there is no interference. So there is enough common mode and differential filtering on the lines as well. So you can refer to the design guide. There is a schematic given, and that schematic has all these components which are making sure that we are reducing the interference between the two chips.
Okay. Maybe you have time for a few more questions here. For TIDA 01580, on the 3LED or 4LED sensor options, how does the baseboard know which one is connected, and does it matter?
Yeah, so that design, right, as I mentioned, it has three boards. There is a PPG board which fits onto ECG board, and there is a window on the ECG board. And then it, so let me go back to that so that it is very clear. So this design, yeah, so here there is one board below this which has the PPG sensor. It fits onto this ECG sensor board, and then the entire board fits into the main board. And it does matter, because the software will change accordingly. The baseboard doesn't know automatically that user has loaded which program, right? So we have to load correct program for the respective sensor board. And we have tried this with two sensors. One is OSRAM sensor, which is available on DigiKey. And one was a custom sensor. We worked with one of the manufacturers from Taiwan, where we have worked with them. So this has been, and both these sensors are highlighted in the design guide. So you can just refer to PIDA 1580 design guide, and that will give you all the details about that those sensors. We can take one more last question, if there are.
Okay. What can be an issue if using reference design in the end user products?
Okay, yeah, we get a lot of questions like this on even on E2E also. So these reference designs are not full systems. These are small subsystems of a bigger product. So you can use this for, let's say if you're developing a product, it can be a small subsystem which can be used in your product. And also, these designs are not clinically tested, or we have not got any approval for these designs as a final product. So they are just evaluation platforms, but instead of providing you just evaluation for one single device, the designs help you with combining multiple devices on a single board. And what we give is, we give the Gerber files, layout, everything on our website. So you can take those and you can produce the boards and test it. These are fully tested designs. So I think any questions can be entertained on E2E if you develop your board based on this design, of course.
Okay, I think with that, we're running out of time. So if anyone has more questions, they can always post it on E2E and we'll get back to you.
Yep, thank you. Thank you for your time. Thanks, Kelvin.
All right. Thanks, Sanjay.